Good morning, afternoon, and evening to our online viewers who are here in worship with us at First United Methodist Church, Homo Sassa, Florida. It is a glorious day here, and we are grateful to be in worship with you. Just wanted to share a couple of announcements before we begin. One, for those of you I haven't had the chance to meet, my name is Patti Aupperlee, and I am honored to be the pastor here at FUMCH, First United Methodist Church, Homo Sassa. Also, I'm grateful for the team that surrounds me, our wonderful musicians, and Brandon and his crew who are helping us with the technology of this. To let you know, we're glad that you are in worship with us. If you are not living in our area, if you happen to be from another state or even outside of the United States, we'd love to know where you're worshiping with us this morning, where your location is. But for all of us, to let you know, as part of the kingdom of God, we are again lifting up the Oasis ministry. It's a ministry that reaches out to women at the Lowell Correction Institute in Ocala, Florida. And currently we're asking our women of the church who feel called and led to write letters to women who are incarcerated to bring a word of hope. You can see the bulletin that has been emailed to you, and it will give you instructions there. As well, we're headed into the latter part of July, and we are gearing up for back to school. We know that there is a lot of unknown and uneasiness as to what the school year will look like, but we partner with Homo Sassa Elementary School, and we are collecting supplies for the students, whether they're going to be at home or in the classroom. So again, we invite you to bring any school supplies to the office and place them in the bin, or contact us if that's not possible, and we'll make arrangements. For example, some of the things that they are looking for are earbuds, colored pencils, composition notebooks, a box of number 2 pencils, glue sticks, colored copy paper, highlighters of all colors, Crayola crayons. They do hold up better than other brands. And we just ask you to log into our website for a comprehensive list. Thank you very much, and we look forward to being in ministry with you this service. Thank you.
We are the church when we stand.
now as we come together, a time of intentional prayer, that as God is continually in the world before us, working in the hearts, the lives of all of his beloved, that we are lifting prayers of intercession, we are lifting prayers of fellowship and community and support for each other. I invite you to take some time and let's listen to how God's Spirit is leading you this morning. Let us pray. Most holy God, as we come before you, we breathe in your Spirit. Fill us with your love and compassion and hope. May we exhale those areas that are a barrier to the work you wish to do within us. May we breathe in your promises to bring us assurances and peace that is beyond our human understanding. But Lord, we trust and stand on the firmness of your love. And Lord, as we exhale those doubts and fears and allow your Spirit to weave within us a strength not of physical might, but a strength of faith. As the world watches our witness, Jesus, that you are proud, that you are delighted in our love for you. Most gracious God, we come before you. We recognize that the chaos of this global pandemic, the unrest in our world, is from the brokenness of sin. Lord, please heal our world. Lord, for those that are struggling this morning with illness, whether it's physical, mental, emotional, Lord, and even spiritual, Lord, hear our prayer for healing. Lord, we ask your provision for those that are struggling financially, the desperation that is felt when we don't know how we're going to make it through the next day. Lord, may we be the people to step up and step out, that you lead and guide us and direct us. And Lord, if we are the people that are feeling so unsteady, bring us that comfort that you will send someone to be a ministry to us. Lord, for healing to take place in relationships that are broken and fractured, Bring us your love. Bring us your compassion. Fill us with your grace. Lord, we come before you humbly. We seek your mercy. Lord, we seek your forgiveness in the ways that we have not been honoring to you, O Lord. Lord, for the ways that we have harmed our neighbors. Lord, for the ways that we have not been honoring to ourselves. Forgive us, we pray. Lord, may this global pandemic, may we be a part of flattening the curve, that we are conscientious of our neighbors, that we wear a mask not for ourselves alone, but because we love our neighbor. Lord, speak to us, please. And Lord, we come before you, our voices together virtually around the world. We come before you, Lord, in this prayer that you have taught through the ages. We proclaim that you are our Father who art in heaven, and hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we come before God in our time of worship, being reminded that this is our second week in our eight-week sermon series, Our Life, Telling God's Story. We're focusing on Hebrews 11, but looking at where these heroes of faith show up in other parts of Scripture. My hope is that you took time this past week to read over chapter 11 in Hebrews. I was happy to hear from a couple of people who had said that they did go back and refresh their memories about the story of Cain and Abel. My hope is that you'll take time each week to refresh yourselves and remind yourselves of these amazing stories. Last week, as we looked at the life of Abel, and saw how he pleased God. This week, our theme continues as we take a look at Enoch's life, a character often not spoken about. And we will look at just the limited part that we know of his story. I wanted to share with you, I love this quote, because Enoch pleased God, that we are told he walked faithfully with God, and it was his life that pleased God. Beth Moore, one of our current theologians, shares this statement, that the giant step in the walk of faith is the one we take when we decide God no longer is a part of our lives. He is our life. So let's take a look and see what we can learn here in 2020, the year of the global pandemic, from these faith saints of old. I wanted to begin by reminding us that we are all connected. It's God, the Creator, who loves the creation he made. It's God sending Emmanuel, God with us. We are God's people, the majority of us, living out God's story here in the wonderful United States of America. Again, please let us know if you are worshiping with us in a location outside the country. We're also connected as we narrow down our focus, that the majority of us continue to be unified through our connection to Homo Sassa, Florida. Many of us either live here year-round, we're winter residents, visitors, or even family and friends that have connected because of the relationships we have with one another. And as we come down a little bit further, we're connected, those of us in worship here this morning, or this afternoon, or this evening, however and whenever you're watching, to be reminded that we are connected as a faith community, celebrating, living, and sharing God's love through First United Methodist Church. We all have some connection together. We share a commonality at some level to this amazing Church of God, whether we share that connection in person or whether we share it virtually. As I was preparing, a side note came along, and I wanted to share with you that I so wish my dad was alive to be here to experience this virtual lifestyle that we're learning to live through this global pandemic. You see, as a kid, I grew up when Star Trek was at its heyday, and that cartoon, The Jetsons, how they would communicate with each other virtually on a screen. My dad thought that was ridiculous. Even cell phones, he was not here to see. Much less the remote control of a TV. The only remote control to a TV was when he told me to get up and change one of three channels that we had. The world is different. But it reminds me that even in our differences through the years, we are connected with our past. See, our passage from Hebrews is intertwined as a part of the story in Genesis from the 10 generations, from Adam up through Noah and the time of the flood. But first, let's go ahead and take a reminder of our first three verses from Hebrews. We're reminded that faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. I hope you can see this picture. It's of a young person who's gripping onto the wall, and what she's walking on is a clear plate of glass. It's a very high bridge on the cliff of a mountain. She has faith and confidence that what she hopes for is that she'll make it to the other side safely. And she's stepping out, trusting who and what has gone before her, that she will journey that safely. Through their faith, the people in the days of old earned a good reputation. They earned a good reputation with God. See, faith is that bridge between where I am and where God is taking me. Where are you? And where are you allowing God to take you? Into those places where we need to rely on God and not just on our own. See, the heroes in the faith of old, they stepped out on faith when it often didn't make sense according to the world standards. For us, believers in the Holy God, in the triune God, we are stepping out on faith that we will have peace and joy and patience and love, even when the world seems like a wild ride. Verse 3 reminds us, by faith we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command, that what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen. Friends, we know more than ever that life is filled with ups and downs and twists and turns, and it sometimes flips us upside down. But it's God who is in control. God's story. This is what we're talking about this sermon series, is seen through our life of faith. It's our life of faith individually and as a community. I found fascinating as I was getting ready for this sermon series, do you realize that there are two Lamechs? Two different people with the same name. See, it's interesting because I'm still trying to put names and faces together here at First Home Osessa. See, I've met a whole bunch of Bobs. I met a few Donnas. There's a lot of Jims, some Sandys. And they're not just names. There's stories in their life, and there's faith lived out. And I want to know each and every one. With Lamech, he's told in Genesis 4, because he comes from the lineage of Cain. Remember, we learned that Cain's life was not pleasing to God. In Genesis 5, we meet another Lamech who comes from the lineage of Seth, who falls into the lineage of Enoch. God's story is told through the 10 generations from Adam to Noah with Enoch. Our passage from Hebrews is intertwined as that part of the 10 generations. I'm going to ask that you stick with me as we take a look at where our writer of Hebrews finds the information that they wrote about in this chapter 11 of Hebrews. But we need to know the story of where that came from. And we're going to look to Genesis chapter 5. It's fascinating who these 10 people are. We learn first from Adam. Adam had his son Seth when he was 130 years old. What we know about Seth is that he was described to be just like Adam. Now, Seth was 105 years old when his son Enosh was born. There's no other description of him except that he had other children. That's all we know. Enosh has Kenan. Kenan was just a baby at the age of 70 when his son Mahalalel was born. But again, the only information we have about Kenan and Mahalalel was that they had other children. But Mahalalel was only 65, a mere child, when Jared was born. Jared was the father of Enoch, who we are reading about today in Hebrews chapter 11. Enoch was a mere 65 years old when he had his son Methuselah. Now, hold up, because unlike the other characters that we read about, we don't just get the information that Enoch had other children. This is different than the rest of those that fall into this lineage. Genesis chapter 5 says about Enoch that he lived in close fellowship with God for another 300 years. But so as not to break the similarity of the cloud of witnesses before him, he does state that he has other children. But the author continues that Enoch lived a long life after that. But he walked in close fellowship with God. Today we're wondering, did Enoch have to wear a mask and stay 6 feet away from God? I don't think so. But it's something that crosses our minds in this time that we're living in. But this lineage, these 10 generations continue. Enoch, then one of his children, has lifted up Methuselah. We don't know much about Methuselah except he had other children. Methuselah then has his son Lamech. Lamech was 182 years old when he then has his son Noah. It's interesting that now, beyond knowing that he had other children, Noah was given the name Noah because his father hoped that he would bring relief from their work and painful labor of farming on the ground that the Lord had cursed. The consequences of sin carry over. Life was hard. But it's been interesting. In my couple of weeks here, church, I've heard you describe yourselves as an elderly congregation. Compared to these 10 men, you're all underage and children. It's amazing what God can do through the people who are willing to walk on faith. Hebrews 11:5. We have the history from Genesis. Not a lot of history, but enough to show us that Enoch gave his life. It wasn't what he did. It was who he was. Hebrews 11:5 states, it was by faith that Enoch was taken up to heaven without dying. He disappeared because God took him. For before he was taken up, he was known as a person who pleased God. 11:6 says, and it is impossible to please God without faith. This verse is for you and I, not just a history lesson. It's for you and I. It's impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists and that God rewards those who sincerely seek him. Oftentimes, we get tripped up. That we get so concerned with pleasing those around us, with pleasing ourselves, that we forget that pleasing God is the most important, the most fulfilling, the most rewarding. Why? Because that's who we're created to be. People who worship God above all else. The story of God shares about what worship looks like, and it's introduced through these characters in Scripture that we are reading about. Oftentimes in our culture, we tend to put an emphasis on things that bring us pleasure. From the type of shampoo that we use, to the cars we drive, to the homes we live in, to the vacations we take. Or did take before this pandemic, we think those are the things that are going to bring us joy. We get tripped up when we lose sight that our purpose, our very reason for being, is worshiping the God who created us, who saved us, who sustains us through amazing grace and love that can't be extinguished. Yep, chaos still swirls around. But we have joy that the world doesn't know. When we give up our will for God's will, it's amazing. The rewards that the world offers, they're those glamorous temptations that Satan lured before Jesus when he was in the wilderness. And Jesus gave us very clear instructions. keep your eyes on God. It's a struggle, but that's why we come together and worship. That's why we're taking time this morning, this afternoon, this evening, whenever you're watching, to be together and be reminded of those saints that have gone before us. But as Enoch walked with God, Abel walked with God, God was pleased. I wanted to share this picture. Is by a pastor. His name is Philip Mentofa. This pastor Philip serves in Indonesia, and he's a gifted artist. And he created this painting, and he was sharing how to do this painting with a group he was leading by YouTube. And so I wanted to share his belief and his view on faith.
Enoch, walking with God. Enoch walked faithfully with God, then he was no more, because God took him away. Genesis 5:24. There are several people described as walking with God in the Bible. Among them, Enoch was the first one. God decided to highlight his example by doing something extraordinary to underscore how much he values intimacy and friendship with him. God took Enoch to paradise. What happens when you walk with a close friend? You are in close proximity. You talk, laugh, listen, and share your hearts. Walking with God is like that, only by faith. We live to fellowship with Him as a lifestyle in a state of unbroken worship. As it is true today, whoever walks with God will enter the dimension where God unfolds the secrets of His kingdom. These are the paths that the ancients trod before us. Now, this is just the painting that will get you started walking down your heavenly flowery lane.
So friends, let's live a life that pleases God. Let us give thanks that the author of Hebrews included Abel and Enoch to remind us it's not what we do, it's who we are. We're people who will please God. Let us pray. Most gracious God, thank you for who you are. Thank you for how you have lifted up Abel and Enoch to remind us of faith is trusting you. Not by how much we can do, but how we can be living into your will. Guide us this week. Give us strength this week. Let us study you more this week. But thank you for the heroes who have gone before us, Lord, and thank you for the people of faith who are in this world today. In your most holy name of Jesus, amen.